So lately, this is a funny one. This is about I've been playing the shaman drums because I have my these tablas and also I've been playing them pretty much regularly for like the last week, and like 1 hour, 2 hours, the drums, and every evening. It's been very strange because here this is the, what do we call it? The dry arid desert. And yet, in the evening, all of the walls in the ground has become saturated with like clouds that have just sat. You know, they've flown in and they've just sat there for a while and then moved on. So the clouds are like attracted, you know. Now I can run around and say, well, it was me, you know, the Indian thing, I'm doing the powwow, I'm making the rain happen. It's very possible, it's absolutely hugely possible. You know, it's a lot of drumming. And drums go at that level, you know, it's a real low frequency, like the elephants, you know, they're just real low, so it goes much further distance. When you play a drum, it can go ooh out there, miles and miles. And so here we are talking about the clouds having that response. And so they did the rain dances, remember? They did the rain dances, they shake things, they pound the ground with their feet, heavy extra, use those shakers, everything, you know, to get this, and the drums, of course, also, all present in the rain dance. So here it is, I'm here making rain dances, and for like the past week, I'm also working on this wall, and I'm trying to get it to dry, and I'm like, gosh dang it, every morning it's just like saturated again, and I'm not able to coat it, because I have to coat another bit of plaster on it. And because it's really better if you let it dry out first before you put the plaster over it, the earth plaster. And I haven't been able to. And I'm like, what is it? It's going on here, you know? This is arid desert. It's not supposed to have any moisture like this. And yet every night I wake up in the morning and there it is, you know? There's water everywhere. I'm like, even like, what's the deal? Is it the pipes of the house? Are the pipes leaking? But no, it's really on the tops of all the walls, all the way around, all the rock walls, everything. And so, the only thing I can absolutely attribute it to is my participation, others who are drumming, who are out there drumming. Okay, so the drums have a rain effect, very much so. I mean, we're looking at 100%. On the barometer of humidity, and this is supposed to be one of the most arid places, you know, on the planet practically, and yet the barometer is just woo, and so the clouds, and then it says clouds passing, and so the drums are bringing in all these clouds, they're running through, and then they stop and get heavy, and then they run by again, and then they stop and get heavy, and then they run by again. So that's what's happening. So it's kind of interesting. Now, I want to take this through to the reality, reason, and how it all happened, and how the clouds themselves are part of the whole cycle. Like originally, these plains here, they were all filled with these buffaloes, and they're running around. Running this way, you know, just thousands of them at once. Okay, so they pick up and they run, you know, and so after that moment happened, they had made a rain dance. You know, at that moment, those buffaloes made a rain dance, and this is probably what the Indians witnessed a long time ago. Was that is the moment when, hey, we get more rain when they pick up and go. Because when they pick up and go, it's loud. It's very loud. And guess what else happens when they pick up and go? they've left behind all of their fertile cow, their cow patties, their buffalo patties, all over the place. Okay, so right there at that moment, you're having the fertilization key. You're having the rain added to the cow patties. So you're having the remake of that cycle happening right away. It's not like the cow patty is going to sit there for 6 months and wait for a rain. It happens like immediately. And so we're looking at a very fertile plain when you had all those buffalo. So right now, because we don't have the buffalo, we just have people in their houses who drum and play their little shaman games and guru, whatever. So now we're in our houses drumming. We're bringing the rain to these cities, to these, I'll call them substandard housing, tract home housing, because it really is a substandard. When I've seen some of the buildings, from that last 500 years and all, I mean, these are just tract home houses all over the place with those little 2x4s or 2x6s if you're lucky. So we have that type of housing, and so we're playing the drums, and yet we're attracting these big clouds, these big huge clouds to just saturate the roofs, the roofs that are not, really wanting that much saturation, that have to be replaced all the blasted time and all of that. So that's what we're looking at is well, now what do we do? What do we do? What do the drummers do? Because when you really get into it, you are a part of that weather. You're a part of that weather cycle. You're bringing it in. And so anyway, I'm gonna not drum tonight. I'm gonna take a couple days off, and I'm gonna see what happens. But most assuredly, in the night, I don't believe we're gonna have a cloud hanging heavy. I don't think it's gonna just sit on the hills, like a donk donk donk. I played the drum, dun, 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 dun. I played the drums, and so now it's just gonna just hang out and go yow, ha ha ha. Like I was the herd of buffalo running away, and leaving something fertile for the rain to have an action with. So yeah, so anyway, how we correlate in the whole picture, we're just a big upset, aren't we? Because it's so beautiful. You look at nature before man was there, and these moments are so beautiful. You take that huge giant herd, and you take all of those clouds, following the herd. Yeah, there they go. And then there they go again. Just following right behind, making a beautiful world. And yet, and now, anyway, they're not banning drums yet, I don't think, in the households, but there might be a time, if there's enough of us, that they might say, hey, we don't want that much rain in our neighborhood. We don't want that much rain on our rooftops. There might be a time. Either that, or we upgrade the houses to accept all of it, to accept all that rain. And I guess thatch, they have to go thatch roofing. That's been working for centuries, thatch roofing. I don't know if we're ever going to get thatch roofing in the Southwest, but that is a method, isn't it? That thatch. Anyway, I've had a terrible time lately with my diet. I fasted for like 10 days, and then or maybe more. It was like 15 days. I went off and on every other day. I ate one meal, and then I fasted, and then I ate another meal every other day, and then I fasted. And I did lose weight, but since then I've just been pigging out. I've been making cakes and pies, and I can't stop. So it's turned me into I now have a fetish over food, where before I was just food. So now the fast has turned me into possessed over needing and wanting it. So it was a bad thing for me. Fasting did not go well. So I'm going to tone out, and I'm not going to make any more cookies. I made gingerbread cookies. I made brownies. I made the pumpkin pies. I made apple pies. I even made a banana nut bread. So I'll let you know, I've been really cooking. And I did make a carrot cake also along the way. And I've been eating all of these things after the fast. So anyway, just to let you know, and I think I have four more. What is the, these are four more of my gingerbread cookies, except for the ones that I put in the freezer that I was gonna give away. And even now in my possessive state over food, I'm even thinking about not giving it away and saving that frozen gingerbreads for myself and the household. So yeah, pretty wretched, isn't it? It's a pretty wretched thing. So when you are and then I have to think about the straw mat. You go back to the gurus on the straw mat, and they're there, and they never seem to put any weight on, but they're actually, most of them are probably starving. And you know, they're just waiting for people to give them a little bit of money for food or a little food here and there. I just think most of them are starving. I feel so sad for them. They're in India there, and they're the gurus, and they're all wrapped up, you know, they have their, you know, can I do it? You know, I guess I can. Oh my gosh. Yeah, so that's one side. Can I do both? Oh, they do both, don't they? Yeah. I don't know about behind the neck there. But yeah, they do this, and then they do that thing when they stand on their hands and all. There's one guy who's in his 80s, but I think he's starving. I think he's been starving a long time. And I think that's the sad of it. I think it's not that they want to fast, to get to that spiritual place or that high, that nirvana, and they're like, oh my gosh, I'm in my second lift out off of myself on the planet, and my third or my fourth today. And so yeah, they could be having constant out-of-body experiences, but in a way I think they're all starving also. So I think that being spiritual, being a guru, and then trying also to eat and have that meditation self is difficult, because when you are meditating and you're fasting, you do have more of these outer body experiences. And that's weird, you know, because if you are forced into starvation for the out of body experience, I don't know, it seems like a drag, doesn't it? The whole thing just seems like a drag, because you want that, you know, you want that. It's in a way, it's like it's an addiction, you know. Once you have it, you know, you want more of it. Give me more out of body. But yet, yeah, that food, the food is canceling it out. So I imagine they'll do studies and say, yes, those who fast more, those who have like long lapses between food, they'll have more out of body experiences. So I imagine that'll show up, and then the ones who eat three meals a day never have any, you know. So that'll be, you know, part of life, you know. Oh yeah, yay. Yeah, so anyway, so that's what they do all day on their straw mats. And then the people walk by, and then maybe they'll give them like a quarter or something. Anyway. So enough's enough. That was my discussion. It was about the relation of, and there were times when you had that power, the Rain Man power, you know. Hey, I'm the power of the Rain Woman, obviously. Okay, so now I have Rain Woman power, shamanic powers. What does that do? What does that do? You know, like, if I was in a tribal self time, I would have been elevated, obviously. Elevated, even cast out, and like, no, we only use her for certain moments. You know, we don't want the rain now. Don't make her mad. She will bring the rain to us, you know. I would have been coddled away and isolated as an instrument to use only at certain moments, you know, predicaments, when they need their crops watered, when they need fresh water, all reasons like that. But for now, I'm just going to be a shamanic little witch here, dedicatedly not thumping on a drum tonight, so my walls can dry a little bit. And anyway, that's exciting, isn't it? Because in a way, it gives power where is nothing to do with this modern time, isn't it? Nothing to do with this modern time at all. It gives power to oneself based upon an entire requiem of ages, you know, since the dawn of time, you know, since clouds existed. It gives that communication, you know, nothing to do with the communication of now. It's the communication of all time, you know, when the cloud, little puffy cloud, just kept walking on by, you know, or staying for a bit, or being attracted. Yeah, superpower. Superpower. I have superpowers.